It's not at all clear how to explain what a chain of communication is either. So I said, if you say, well, Rumsfeld, I think, is the name of a pre-Socratic philosopher, I just picked up a little bit of conversation about Rumsfeld, about known unknowns and all that, and I thought, yeah, that's a pre-Socratic, sounds like a pre-Socratic to me. Then do you really understand the name? I mean, the chain, the causal chain, goes back to Donald Rumsfeld's initial baptism. No arguments about that, that's really what's going on, from your use of the name back to the politician's baptism. But if your use of the name is so out of joint, if you raise questions like, did Rumsfeld influence Plato, your use of the name seems to be so out of sync with any talk about the politician, that you wonder what point is there in saying you're referring to the politician. Evans writes, one could regard the aim of this paper as being to restore the connection which must exist between strict truth conditions, including the account of reference, and the beliefs and interests of the users of the sentences, if the technical notion of strict truth conditions is to be of interest to us. So that's to say, talking about what someone's referring to isn't a purely technical exercise. It has to fit in with how, it has to relate to the kind of interest that our thought and talk have for us, what work thought and talk do in our everyday lives. It's not just a technical question, what you're referring to when you use a sign. And so here's an example to suggest that the initial dubbing ceremony that Kripke talks about can't really have that kind of force that Kripke supposes. Suppose one of a group of villagers dubbed a little girl on holiday in the vicinity Goldilocks, and the name caught on. However, suppose there were two identical twins that the villagers totally failed to distinguish. It just happened that at the initial dubbing, one of them ran in range of the dubber, and the dubber said, I dub thee, Goldilocks. And it was an accident to get that one rather than the other one. The two of them keep running around. Then Evans says, I should deny that Goldilocks is the name of either. I mean, since, in the life of the villagers, there is no significant distinction drawn between the two twins, the mere accident that a dubbing ceremony caught one of them rather than the other can be of no relevance. Here's another example. An urn is discovered in the Dead Sea containing documents on which are found fascinating mathematical proofs. Inscribed at the bottom is the name Ibn Khan. And for decades, mathematicians study these proofs, talk about what Ibn Khan didn't understand, talk about Ibn Khan's level of mathematical sophistication, and so on. And they've never noticed, but right at the bottom, in very small print, it says, id scripsit, I'm the scribe, I'm the humble writer down of the proofs, not the mathematician myself. And then it says, are you really going to say that when for decades mathematicians have been arguing about whether Ibn Khan was really in a position to prove, let us say, the incompleteness of arithmetic, they were talking about the scribe, because that's the person who was first dubbed, Ibn Khan? No, they were talking about the mathematician. So Kripke's talk about the importance of the initial dubbing seems to be giving an importance to an almost accidental ceremony that it doesn't really have. And the idea of the chain of communication is also pretty problematic. Kripke says, what's a chain of communication? Well, when the name's passed from link to link, the receiver of the name must, I think, intend when he learns it to use it with the same reference as a man from whom he heard it. And Evans's point is, that can't be a correct account of the chain of communication. Consider Marco Polo's naming of Madagascar. Marco Polo is standing in the mainland, presumably around Mozambique somewhere, looking out at this great island, and he says to the locals, what do you call that? And they think he's pointing to a bit of the mainland. They think he's pointing to the hills over the coast. And they say, that's Madagascar. And he takes them to be referring to the island. So he's making a mistake about what they're referring to. He thinks they're referring to this. They are actually telling him the local name of a bit of the headlands out in Mozambique. And he is intending, in Kripke's phrase, he is intending to use it with the same reference as the people from whom he heard it. But he's not. I mean, if you really took Kripke's story seriously here, then there's a chain going from you and me today, and the makers of this map today, back through to Marco Polo, back through to the locals back then, all of us intending to use the name with the same reference as the people from whom we heard it, right back to the locals' initial dubbing of that bit of the headland, Madagascar. So if we really took Kripke's theory seriously, you'd have to say, Madagascar's not an island. Madagascar's just a bit of the mainland of Africa. That's a crazy view. That's the thing about this. This would be a purely technical notion of reference, but it doesn't bear any relation to the way we actually use the name Madagascar every day, or how we actually assess what each other are saying is true or false. Okay, so the basic point there about the Madagascar example is that reference can shift despite a causal chain on an intention to preserve reference. And we've actually had this point already. I mean, in that affecting story of Spot, that's exactly what happens. I mean, I won't walk through that painful story again, but yeah, you can remember it, right? It's the same model. Okay? Okay, so that's the Evans's line of attack in Kripke. Now, there are, well, what he does to respond to Kripke is he introduces the notion of a dominant source of information. And when you try and explain this abstractly, I think it's quite a difficult notion to give a fully explicit account of. So I'll work through his attempt to give a fully explicit account of it, and then I'll look at his example. I think the example of Napoleon makes it very vivid what he means, and makes it very clear that there is some idea there, however unsatisfactory the notion of a dominant source of information is. Your task as homework is to improve that definition of a dominant source of information. Here's the kind of definition that Evans gives. A speaker intends to refer to the item that is the dominant source of the associated body of information. So in the case of Madagascar, you get a bunch of information about Madagascar, you have a whole bunch of impressions about Madagascar, you have your file on Madagascar. What matters is not who is at the end or what is at the end of some long historical chain going back through the centuries. What matters is, look at your body of information as you have it now. What is the dominant source of all that information? Is it the island or is it the headland? Usually our knowledge or belief about particular items is derived from information gathering transactions involving a causal interaction with some item or other conducted ourselves. Or as in the case of Madagascar, you can get it through a long chain, or if it's someone who's moved in next to you, you can get it just by directly interacting with them, not through a long chain. You can find out about a person from a perception, from a photograph, from rifling through their suitcase, from burgling their house, or finding out what other people say. You can find all about this person one way or another, and that gives you a file, that gives you a cluster or a dossier of information on that person. Now, when you're getting that cluster, putting together your file on that person, you might mix up information from different people. A cluster or dossier of information can be dominantly of an item, though it contains elements whose source is different. So if you've got a photograph like this, I was trying to find a photograph I could show at this hour of the morning of two people kind of all tangled up. So here you have information coming from two rugby players, right? Yes? Yes, that's all right, so you're getting information here. So it's all mixed up, but in my view, your information is dominantly of the guy in the front. You're getting more and clearer information about the guy in the front. So even although you've got here something that is giving you information about two different people, you can say, well, it's really dominantly of one rather than the other. And it says dominance is not simply a function of the amount of information. Even if you could quantify information, it's not just going to be a matter of how much information. In the case of persons, for example, each man's life presents a skeleton, and the dominant source may be the man who contributed to covering most of it, rather than the man who contributed most of the covering. So what he has in mind, I think, if, for example, we know a bit about, let's say, Maxwell, the great physicist, then it may be that we actually have some scans that were done of Maxwell's knee that give you a massive amount of information about Maxwell's knee. So we know far more about his knee than we know about anything else that Maxwell did. Even if that scan, it turned out we were all wrong about it. That wasn't really Maxwell's knee at all. You see what I mean? That could happen, too. What matters is not who contributed most of that information, if most of the information relates to the knee. What we want is where the overall shape of Maxwell's life and achievements comes from, the overall picture. That's it. So the important thing is who contributed to covering most of the skeleton, not the fact that you're getting a massive amount of detail of some relatively unimportant part of the skeleton. I'm whistling through this a little bit, but because I hope it's plain enough, but help me at any point. You might want to speed up a bit, which is hard to do, but it's just, okay. Happy with that? Okay. So dominance is, so detail in a particular area can be outweighed by spread. Detail in the coverage of the knee can be outweighed by spread in the coverage of the life, and your reasons for being interested in the item at all will also weigh. So Imogen Dickey has a couple of examples that really test out this notion of dominance. One is, these are in the paper just out this year. One is, suppose you have a village with an astrologer who fastens onto a two-year-old child and says, this little girl will do great things. This little girl is a child of destiny. She generates a whole bunch of predictions about the great things this little girl will do for the village. And maybe 10 years down the line, those legends are alive and well, and people remember relatively little about the actual life of the little girl. Still, that little girl is a person you're talking about. That little girl is a person that all the legends are of, even though the little girl contributed relatively little to all these fabulous legends that have grown up around her. Or again, it could happen that with Chaucer, it could have been that in the Middle Ages, a whole bunch of myths grew up about Chaucer, the early English writer, and people in the Middle Ages believed mostly a bunch of nonsense about Chaucer, so that actually they believed he was a saint, they believed he had magical powers, I don't know, whatever stuff you like, but actually Chaucer himself was not the dominant source of all these legends. It could still be that eventually all these legends were scraped away and we got stories about the real Chaucer. I usually just love to, I would like to stop for questions, but I'm going to just blast through if that's all right, and then we'll see if there's any time left, because I just want to get to everyone's example of Napoleon. Okay, what's the question? Really quickly. Sorry? It's like what? Chuck Norris, yeah. Is it? Is that like Chuck? I actually don't, I'm sorry to say I don't know who Chuck Norris is. is that like Chuck Norris? It is like Chuck Norris. Well, there you go. I will look that up for next time. Okay. Well, thank you, that was clearly very helpful. Right. Now you understand, now it all falls into place. Okay. Okay, well, okay. Evans' own example is Napoleon. So that's a picture of Napoleon encountering the Sphinx. Napoleon is the one on the left in the hat. Okay, here are two scenarios Evans discusses. Suppose an impersonator took over Napoleon's role from 1814 on. So this is Napoleon in his mature phase, as you can see. This is Napoleon after his great military victories, after he's been released from prison, or got out of prison, and an imposter takes over at that late stage, and it's actually an imposter of the mature Napoleon who fights at Waterloo and loses. Okay, suppose that happened, and then the historians say, how would the historians describe that situation? Would you say Napoleon fought at Waterloo? Waterloo happens later, right? Waterloo was just about the last big thing that happened. Yes, Napoleon fought at Waterloo? Sorry, if... yes. Let's suppose that the historians now know the situation. Oh. Right, you're perfectly right, they would say that, but let me put it another way. If they said that he fought at Waterloo, Napoleon fought at Waterloo, would they be right? Okay, anybody think they'd be right? Very good. Okay, now then, the thing is, because, just summing up what we all think, here is mid-career Napoleon unifying Europe under the French Empire, and this is the person who's the dominant source of all our beliefs about Napoleon. What happened when he was beat at Waterloo? I mean, in the English mind, that ranks pretty high, but it's actually not, you know, what you think of his main achievement, if you see what I mean. Yeah? So Napoleon refers to who the dominant source of our cluster of beliefs about him, which is this guy out there unifying Europe. Yeah? But now consider another scenario. Suppose that an impersonator takes over when Napoleon is just starting out. As you can see, here he is, hardly a beard, no hat. So he's just beginning, and then an impersonator does him in and takes over. This guy here is actually the person who took over, the person who did him in, and took over at that point. So then the cluster of the typical historian would be dominantly of the impersonator. Yes? So if Napoleon was done in and taken over, if this guy was done in and taken over at a relatively early age, our cluster of beliefs that we associate with the name Napoleon would be dominantly of this guy. Yep, the guy who'd taken over. The mid-career Napoleon. Yes? So in that case, if we said Napoleon fought at Waterloo, would that be true or false? It would be true. True is the official answer. Everything is negotiable here. Put your hand up if you think it's true. If you think it's false? If you have no idea what I'm talking about? Let me just check. Put your hand up if you do know exactly what I'm talking about, but maybe you're just not sure about the answer. Okay, I have to say that is less than overwhelming, but okay. So here's Evans diagramming the situation. He says, here is the first case in which we have the early Napoleon making it through to mid-career before he is sandbagged and someone else takes over. And then when you say Napoleon is F, what you're talking about is this character. Yep, the character who made it through to his mature years before being bumped off. Yes? Whereas in this case, when our character gets bumped off pretty early, in this case when you're talking about the dominant source of this collection of beliefs, then really you're talking about this person, Peter. If I'm explaining this correctly, this should be fairly straightforward. Yeah. So the thing is that if you take this example to heart, then cookies kind of, it's a causal picture, all right. But what matters is, who's the dominant source of the information you have right now? Tracing back a causal chain through the mists of time to some initial dubbing isn't really to the point. It doesn't really matter what the initial dubbing was. That's not the critical thing. What matters is who's the dominant source of a set of beliefs that you have right now. One, two. Yeah. That's true. Yeah. That's right. Yeah. You could cast it in terms of, I hadn't thought of that, but you could cast it in terms of which dubbing is important. Yeah, I think part of the point of Evans's picture is to take away the idea of the dubbing ceremony itself as being an important idea. Yeah, because, yeah, yeah. Gotcha, yeah. That's correct. That's a very interesting case, because in that case, you might think that the my father part is really dominant. Yeah, it needs more discussion now. Okay, let's take up that kind of thing next time. Okay, thank you.